So, ciao tutti. That's about how far my Italian goes. So we do the rest in English. So welcome everybody. I'm glad that you stayed for the late hour. Welcome to my talk called Building Modular Java Applications in the Cloud Age. Anybody recognize where this picture is taken? No, you don't recognize it. This is Dubai. And this is the ultimate city of, you know, clouds and high-rise buildings. This is the tallest building in the world. And well, we're going to build some stuff in this hour as well. Well, I'm going to do some coding. And there's actually two main points that I want to stress. And one is on building modular Java applications. I'm going to show you how to do that and how easy that actually is and what you can achieve by building modular Java applications. And then there's this whole cloud touch to the talk, in which I will tell about a little bit of cloud technology. We're going to build some web applications, obviously, that we will deploy in the cloud later on. And I'm going to show you how modular software and deploying stuff into the cloud go together. Let me grab this. So let me quickly introduce myself. My name is Bert Erdman. I'm from the Netherlands. I work for a company called Luminous. We are a services company. We do some R&D ourselves. And some of the products that we develop on are open source projects. A number of Apache projects are being worked on by my company. And I will show you some of the stuff that we built during the presentation. So in my day job, I'm what they call a fellow. Actually, nobody knows what that means. I'd like to call myself a firefighter. So I do some firefighting and I rescue the occasional cat from the tree every now and then. And then besides my day job, I'm also the Java user group leader for the NLJUG, which is the Netherlands Java user group. And we have about 4,000 members and we organize all sorts of events. And just like CodeMotion, we have a conference as well. It's a one-day conference called JFOL. It attracts about 1,250 people each year. We've been doing it for 10 years now. The picture on the right over here is a book that I just recently finished with one of my co-workers. It's called Building Modular Cloud Applications with OSGI. And because I was traveling by plane, I could only fit one into my luggage. So I brought one, and at the end of the talk, well, we'll figure something out to raffle it off to one of you. So if you want to have it, you have to stay till the end. So if you want to reach out to me after this talk, you can do so via email or on Twitter. I'm pretty active on Twitter as well. And if you have any questions, please come to me after the talk. So the topic of today is modularity. And if we want to talk about modularity, then we got to, you know, look at software development in general. And there's a couple of interesting trends and a couple of interesting observations that we can make. A couple of trends that we are seeing today is that applications that we build tend to grow bigger. So we're automating more stuff. We're creating bigger applications. And the stuff that we're trying to do is actually more complex. So we're adding in more complexity and we're also writing more code. And the interesting thing about this is that the way we develop software has become more and more agile. So we're using agile techniques in order to come up with this software, right? So stuff like agile development and refactoring are really common nowadays. And this is the way that we produce our software systems. And it's actually an interesting paradox. Because if we write more code, bigger applications and more complex applications, but we don't, you know, sit down and spend like 2 months on doing requirements, actually when we start building software, we have no idea what we're actually building, right? So the whole requirements come and go along the way, right? We have some rough ideas and then we just start on coding and then along the way, the actual design of the system evolves. This is an interesting trend. And if I look at some of my personal observations in projects that I've been involved with in the past couple of years or so, then I was involved in a number of projects where we started extremely agile. We just had a rough idea. We had a new business idea and we needed some software to go with that idea in order to make it happen. And if you're in like a startup setting, then the first mover advantage is really important. Because if you have this great new business idea, you have to be the first that has the application in order to reach your market share and then, you know, move on from there. So this actually came down to having a rough idea, writing some code, showing it to some, you know, customers who do like a beta trial for your software. And then when they give their feedback and then when new requirements start arising, we just keep on changing the code, right? So essentially our code base was, you know, changing all the time. So our architecture and our code base is changing all the time. And being able to deal with change in a code base is really hard. I mean, not in the first week, but it's going to be hard after a couple weeks or after a couple months or maybe after 2 years, right? If your code changes all the time, if you take stuff out, you throw it away, you put new stuff in, it's going to be a big mess. So we need to have something to cope with that change. And then comes the cloud, right? So the cloud, well, takes all your pains away, it takes all your troubles away, at least that's what they say, but in reality, it's actually making things a little more complex as well. Because some of the non-functional system characteristics that we got used to, like distribution and scalability and performance, right, they tend to be a little different when you go to the cloud. If you go to cloud systems, then you have to deal with, you know, nodes of a certain size, so your system will probably be highly distributed. It will be, well, from an architectural standpoint, it will maybe be more complex than running on-premise applications. And you also have to deal with this problem of deploying software that you write on your machine onto a machine that you cannot see and that resides somewhere on the other end of the internet, right? So we don't want to be this man, right? Old man yelling at cloud. So we want to have solutions for these practical problems. And the good thing is that, you know, I can talk a lot about problems, but we already know the answer. Because the answer to all of the problems that I'm going to propose today is modularity. And modularity is not something that I came up with or that my company came up with, unfortunately not. But it's actually based on really old ideas. I think it was first proposed by Professor Edsger Dijkstra. I think it was in the late 60s, maybe beginning of the 70s. And he wrote some research papers about modularity. And the stupid thing is that, you know, in software design, we just tend to forget brilliant ideas, right? So we throw everything away, we have a new toy, a new programming language, and we start with all the same mistakes, right? And after 10, 15, 20 years, then we start thinking about, you know, best practices and design rules and architecture, and then these old ideas come back, and they become hot and trending again. So same thing with modularity. So modularity has been there for a long, long time. And now we have the tools I'm going to show you. We have a lot of tools which we can really make this happen. So what is modularity? Let me try to explain it to you in the most simple way I can come up with. This is what I learned about system design while I was in university. And since we are in a university right now, let me try to explain it to you. So actually the first rule of designing your application is to prevent tight coupling in your system. So don't tie everything together, but promote cohesion instead, right? So I tried to illustrate that using a diagram. So over here I have this diagram, and you see all these black dots. So imagine that those black dots are Java classes. And some of those Java classes, they need each other in order to perform some functionality, right? So they have some sort of coupling. But then there's other classes in the same system, maybe classes living over here, that also have some form of coupling with other classes, but they don't have anything to do with classes living there. So the idea of modularity is trying to abstract the tight coupling by encapsulating it in something else. So in this case, I just drew this box, and this box is what you can call a module. Right, so the module isolates the more tightly coupled parts of my system from other tightly coupled parts of my system. Right, and if you just look at your system as a couple of boxes, then you can start connecting the boxes together using the red line over here. And that's what I like to call cohesion, because yes, there is some form of coupling between the boxes as well, but it's really well-defined coupling. And it goes through contracts, right? Like really hard contracts. So you have to obey the rules of the contract in order to make these blocks, these modules work together. So this is actually the most simple explanation of modularity that I could actually think of. And I'm going to do it in code in just a minute. Right, so I think that's my cue. Let's stop talking and show you some coding. So the guy who was here previously, he dropped some water, so I should be careful that I don't slip. I'm completely wired up, so I hope everything just keeps on working. I don't electrocute myself. So let me switch over to a development environment. It's a little bit small, so I try to bump the font a little bit. This is Eclipse. Actually, this is just a plain version of Eclipse. And the only thing that I did to it, I installed a plugin into it, which is called BND Tools. I'm going to show it to you in a minute. So we're going to start with a clean project. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to build a new BND Tools OSGI project, because OSGI is going to be the framework that I will be using in order to achieve modularity. And don't worry, it's going to be easy. So what we're going to do is we're going to build a little survey application. And since I installed Java 8 on my machine, some settings are messed up, so I have to be careful not to ruin anything. So I'm just going to start from an empty project. So BND Tools has taken me through a couple of wizards. So I'm just going to start with an empty project. So I have nothing up my sleeves. Actually, I don't have really long sleeves, so I can't put anything in there. And then BND Tools asks me, well, I see you don't have a configuration project yet. Do you want to create one? I say, well, that's fine. And then I want to switch perspective. And press finish one more time, probably. You see spinning beach ball. This is Eclipse. Little bit of patience, and then everything's there. All right, so far, not a lot of magic has happened. I've created a new Java project, which uses the BND plugin. I have this empty configuration project that will hold my modules later on. And then I have a new menu at the top over here, which is called BND Tools. And this is where I will open the repository configuration, and I will add some magic in here, in order to be able to find some libraries that I will be using later on. So I just have a snippet over here. You don't have to remember this. I just add some libraries. And actually what this does is, in the bottom left corner over here, just click refresh. And this is a collection of repositories that I'm going to use while developing some stuff. They actually behave just like Maven repositories, right? So they just hold a whole number of bundles for me. So I just added the Amdatu repositories. Amdatu is an open source project that I work on. And the Amdatu has it has a lot of OSGI ready cloud components that you can use when developing these applications. It's all open source, so don't worry about any commercial lock-in. Right, so we're going to use that later on. So far I've created an empty project, so let's start writing some code. And as I just explained, it's really important to do the interface implementation separation. So let's start by writing. Let's start by creating a bundle. In the OSGI terms, a bundle is a module. So I just create a bundle descriptor. I call this API. This is where my API code will reside. And then BND Tools ask me if I want to enable sub-bundles. Well, that's fine. So I have a bundle descriptor, and now we can start adding code, just like in a regular Java project. So I say, well, give me an interface, which I call survey. It goes in a package called survey.api. Right, and now just to save you some time and not making all the typos, I create a simple interface over here called survey, and it has two methods. So one is to add a score into the system, and the other is to list the scores of the survey from the system, right? So it's complaining it doesn't know about score, which is because I haven't created it yet. So let's create the score class as well. There's going to be a Pojo, which has some of the fields to hold my survey in. So actually there's nothing special, just a plain old Java object. It has a name, which holds the name of the person filling out the survey. Then it has an email address, so you can identify him. It has a score. And then you can add a comment if you like the session or not, right? So now let's save these two classes. If your eyes are really good, especially from the back, you see there's some little red icon over here, and it says this is excluded, because I didn't add this API yet to my module. So I go back to my module definition over here, the survey.api, and actually it has two departments, so to say. Right? This looks like two departments. So it has a private packages in which your implementation code goes that nobody can touch. And then it has a public department, which says export packages, in which code goes that you explicitly want to share with other modules in your system. So this is an API, so this is code that is meant for sharing, right? So I just take the API over here, I just take the package, and I just drag it into the public part of my descriptor. then BND tools will say, oh, well, I will just give you the version. So I will version this version 1.0. And then I will generate some stuff for you in the background. So now if I save this, I have a new folder over here called generated. I hope you can all see that. And then I see a jar file being generated by BND tools. And this jar file actually contains the classes. I can open it up for you so you can see it. So it has my package, survey, API, and then my classes that I just added. And it has something else in the meta-inf directory, which is called a manifest file. And in this manifest file, there's a couple of headers. There's like a name and a symbolic name, so I can refer to it later on. It has a version. And more importantly, it has the export package header, which says, well, this part of your jar file is meant to be explicitly shared with other modules in the system. All right, so we get back to that in a minute. So far, I've just got an API, so I want to do some implementation. So the implementation can go in another module. So I will now create a new module. So let's create another bundle descriptor for that. Let's call it simple, because it will just be a very simple implementation. And then I will create another class in a package, which I will call survey.simple. And then I will call a class that says simple survey service. And then this simple survey service actually implements the survey interface from the public module, right? So it refers to the other module by just saying, well, give me the public class from that, and then I will just implement this interface. So this interface describes two methods, the add score and the list score, which have a pretty, you know, easy implementation. And then I have a thread save list in memory in which I will keep the scores. Right, so this is not really rocket science, just a very simple implementation, just like the name suggests. Now, this code is implementation code. So implementation code should go in a private department of the module, because it is not meant to be shared. Of course, the functionality is meant to be shared, but nobody should be able to touch this class, because if you have a direct dependency on this class, and you try to replace it with something else, it will break, right? So in order to make this class available to the OSGI runtime and make it available for other classes to connect to, I will wire it to the OSGI service registry. And for that, I'm going to create a new class. So I put a second class into the same package. I call this an activator. So you see, I separate my regular code and my OSGI code. So there's no OSGI specific stuff in my normal business logic. And this activator, I'm going to implement it in a second. I just need to add something on my build path. So instead of using the regular Eclipse build path, I'm going to use the BND tools build path. So I add something here to the build path. And what I will be adding is I need some base class from OSGI, and I am going to need something which is called the Apache Felix Dependency Manager. So Apache Felix is the OSGI framework that I will be using. And then Dependency Manager is one of the many frameworks that you have in OSGI for wiring up classes together. Just need that one. And then when I press save, it's being added to my build path, so I can compile against it. And then I can go back to my activator class that I just started working on. And then I can extend. Oops. Oh, Eclipse is giving me a hiccup. And I'm going to add an implement. So I'm going to extend something which is called the dependency activator base, which is some base class which goes in the Felix dependency manager. And then it has two methods, a destroy and an init. And I'm going to do a little bit of work in the init method over here. So what I will be doing is I'm going to add a new component to the OSGI service registry. So this takes a method which is called create component. And if I want to create a component, I need to set an interface first. So I say, well, the interface for this component is going to be the survey. So I'm implementing the survey interface here, right? So I set the name of the survey interface, and then I don't pass in any parameters. And then I need to set the implementation class. Don't worry, I'll show it to you in a formatted way in a second. And the implementation class is going to be this service. So it's going to be this simple survey, oops, typo, service.class. You see, that's why I use code templates, because my typing sucks. I'll just a little bit of formatting. I need to import my interface. Now everything is there. So what I do here, I use the dependency manager that I got injected here to add a new component. And this component has two parts. The interface, which my class implements, which is the interface of the public component. And then I need to set the implementation class, which is the simple survey service that I just created. Now I can save this. And then I go back to my bundle descriptor, so the bundle descriptor for the simple component. And then here I set the activator class. Oops. And then BND tools will automatically list my package in the private packages, because it now knows its implementation code, so it's not meant to be shared with other modules. And then if I press save, and I have now two modules ready, so I can show you the second as well. I have the second jar file here. I can show it to you as well. Right, so the code is in here, and then the OSGI metadata is in here. Now, let's just close everything and start running something. So in order to start running something, I go back to my BND tools project descriptor. I go to the run tab over here. And the first thing I have to do is set the OSGI framework that I'm going to use. So I have a couple installed, so I just pick one. Doesn't really matter. And then I set the Java language level, which is 1.7. And then I go to this window over here. And now I have to specify to the OSGI runtime which modules I want to deploy. So I just press the add button over here. So of course I want to do my own modules, right? So the API and the simple need to be there. Then I need the dependency manager bundles, because I need dependency manager at runtime. And I think that's about it. So I just press finish, and then I press this resolve button over here. Now the OSGI resolver will look in my metadata from all the bundles I just included, and it will try to figure out if there's any transitive dependencies to other modules. So it figures that out, and it needs a couple more. So I just press finish here, just something that the runtime does for me. Now press save, still nothing happens. And then I go to run OSGI over here. And now the system will start the Apache Felix OSGI runtime. It will deploy the list of bundles that I just added in the runtime. And then hopefully something will run. So let me see what happens. Actually, you see nothing happening. So I need to open a console view. And actually, you see nothing. Well, you see something. You see this red square over here, which means something's running, right? But we can't see it. So I just leave it running. I go back to this add icon over here, and I'm going to add some more bundles into my running framework. I'm going to add something which is called the GoGo shell, which is a shell to interact with the OSGI runtime. So I add a couple bundles, press finish, resolve them, press finish again. And now, if you look carefully at the console over here, I'll just put it a little bit higher up so you can see. If I press save now of my new configuration, you see something happening. You see, we get a console. So I didn't restart anything. The system just kept on running. I threw in some new bundles, some new modules, and now we see some output. So now we can toy with the console. So I can do an LB command, which is list bundles. And then we can see which bundles are now in the system, right? So obviously there's a system bundle which contains the OSGI runtime. And then there's my bundles, the service.api, and there's a service.simple. And there's the other bundles that I included when I created the list of runtime modules that I need in order for this application to do something. So, well, you see that there's something going on, but you can't see anything yet. So let's go back to our simple survey service and do some work. So one of the nice things about the Apache Felix Dependency Manager is I can add a public void start method to a service, then I can write some initialization code if the service gets started by the system. So what I can do is I can just add a score. So we can say, well, add a new score. So we got to have a name for someone filling out this score. So I'll say it's going to be Julius Caesar. And he needs an email address as well. So email's going to be badass@hotmail.com. I figure he probably has a Hotmail address. And then he's going to give me a score. He's going to give me a 4 out of 5. And he says, well, Veni, Vidi, and I like it. All right. So there we go. And whoops. And then just to, well, give you some eye candy, let's do a good old-fashioned debug statement, system.println, and said, add a new score. Right? Now, watch when I press save. So I press save right now. And there you see, added new score. Right? So this whole development turnaround experience is pretty nice, because I just write some code, I just press save, and then in the back, the BND Tools plugin is recompiling my module, so it's generating a new service.simple.jar file. Then when it's done generating the new file, it just inserts it into the running OSGI runtime that will automatically shut down the previous version of this jar, and then it will replace it with the new version of my simple.jar, and then it will restart the service, and then you see the login coming. So this is a very nice coding experience. So I can just keep on adding code, throwing stuff away, adding new stuff, and I don't have to restart my OSGI framework at all, right? So no waiting for 30 seconds to launch a new application server or something like that. I can just keep it running, and it will just replace everything itself. Right. So this is just the very basics of OSGI, and I hope you see that doing OSGI is not really that much more complicated than just doing regular Java development. I had to do some OSGI specific stuff, but that went into the Activator class, which was separated from all of the rest of my business logic. So even if I'm not using OSGI with this code, I can still use this code for something else, because the business logic is clean and it's there's no OSGI specific stuff in there. So now let's step up a little, and let's get us to the cloud. So let's do some web development, right? So let's go to the project and say, well, I want to add a new bundle descriptor, and I want to call the REST, because we're going to add some RESTful web services. That's really cool to do in a cloud application, right? So I create this new descriptor. Let me just quickly drop this down a bit so I have some more real estate. And we're going to add some more code. Let's say I want to have a class that goes into a package called survey.rest, and then I'm going to do a survey resource, which is the REST terminology that you should use, and then replace this with some code. I got to do a couple imports. What's wrong here? Okay. Yeah, I need to add something to my build path, of course, because it doesn't know how to compile the REST stuff. So I go to my build path again, press button over here, and then I need some REST stuff. So I'm gonna, browse to this Amdata repositories, and I see, hey, there's a web.rest.jaxrs, which is the Java API for XML RESTful services. And then there's something called rest.wink, and Wink is also an Apache project, which is a implementation of JAX-RS. So I have a RESTful implementation as well. So I add these to my path so I can compile against them. And I press save. And now if we go back to this and I organize imports, hopefully when I press save, everything goes away, but it doesn't. So something is wrong here. Not sure what. Media type. Okay. AWT? I don't think so. Let's organize it again. So it took the wrong import. And now everything should be fine. Yes. So let me take you to this code. I don't know if you have any experience with writing RESTful web services, but it's actually a pretty nice API. So what I'm doing here, I just create a public class. I'm not implementing anything here because I'm not implementing another survey. I'm just using the survey here. So in order to make this a RESTful resource, I add this annotation over here, add path, and I give it a name, a URI, so I can point to it from my browser later on. And then I have a couple of methods in here, two get methods and a post method. Don't bother about the two below, just concentrate on this one for a while. So this listens to an HTTP get request, and then it will produce some JSON output. And what it will do, it says list score, so it will create a list holding scores, and it takes them from survey, and it calls the list scores method on it. So this survey thing is a variable I got here of type survey, and pay attention, this is the interface type, not the implementation class, right? Because I cannot touch the implementation class because it's not visible to me here. But I can use the public type from the API. So in order to use this survey, some magic has to happen somewhere where there will be an actual implementation injected with a working survey. So in that case, we're going to call upon OCI once again in order to wire a survey implementation into this class. So the RESTful resource is now done. I will come back to the other methods in a couple minutes. What I'm going to do right now is I go back to my package over here that holds my resource, and I'm going to add a second class in there, and I'm going to call this an activator as well. And once again, I'm going to extend the dependency activator base class, and I'm going to add the unimplemented methods and say I need a dependency manager over here. So, well, you know the drill right now. So it's going to be dm.add. So I'm going to start the RESTful service when it will be deployed in the OCI container. And so I have to do a create component. And then I have to set the interface of this thing. So in this case, the interface of my RESTful resource is not of type survey, right? Because this is not an implementation of the survey. The interface of this thing is actually of a RESTful web service. Now, a RESTful web service is not something that is meant to be shared on the Java level, right? It's meant to be shared on the RESTful level. So in this case, the interface doesn't really matter. So I'm going to say object.class.getName. So it will be registered, but nobody is able to get a hold of this service because it doesn't have a meaningful name. So I set the properties to null, and then I have to set the implementation class, which is important because it does have to bootstrap the right class. And this is survey resource, if I'm not mistaken. Yes. And then let me do some formatting again so you can see. Right, so I create the component, set the interface to be, well, something stupid because it doesn't really matter. I don't want to reuse it on the Java level. And then I set the implementation class that needs to be bootstrapped, which is the survey resource.class. Now, I'm not done yet. I need to do something more because I need to do the wiring of an actual survey implementation into my resource. So I'm going to say .add, and then I'm going to create a service dependency. And the service dependency has a reference to a service, and the service is going to be of type survey. So I have no idea which class it will be, but I know I want to have a survey. So I need to import that class over here, and I can press save, hopefully. Yes. So formatted a bit nicely. So I added an extra service dependency. I say I need something of this type. So I asked the OSGI runtime, give me some implementation of the survey class and inject it into my class, and my class in this case is the survey resource, and it will inject it into the type or into the variable which has the same type, right? If you have multiple variables of the same type, you can add some extra properties in order to distinguish between them, but I will go for default values over here. So let me save this, and now I can go back to my module definition of my RESTful resource, and I just simply set the activator class that I just created. I have to pick the right one. then it will automatically put everything in the private packages, because once again, this is implementation classes, so it's not meant to be shared on the Java level. And then I press save, and now you see some exceptions scrolling by, because it's immediately publishing this module in the OCI runtime, but the dependencies are not there yet. So I go to my run tab over here, and I'm going to add a little bit of the dependencies, so the exceptions will go away. So first I need the two REST classes, so I need JuxaRest and the Wink implementation. And then I'm going to add two more. So I'm also going to use the Felix HTTP Whiteboard class, which will do whiteboard style registration of my RESTful resource for me. And then I need one more that I'm not really needing right now, but otherwise I will forget it later on. I'm going to use a resource handler for some static stuff I will add later on. So I have everything in place. I press resolve, and hopefully it will resolve. Yeah, appears to be fine. And now if I press save over here, we see some new logging popping up, which is actually starting a Jetty HTTP server. That sounds good. And then if I do a list bundles again, I see I have a whole number of bundles in the system. And one is resolve, which is my RESTful component that filled earlier on. So I will start it by hand. Say start 11. And then if I list my bundles, everything is active. And now hopefully we can go to a browser. So I can go to Chrome. And then to localhost. What did they call it? Survey. And there we have it. Right. So it now lists the contents of my simple memory list as a JSON message, right? So there it is. So, well, this is nice. But about this wiring thing. So I have two completely separate modules, and they share API types. And based on the API type, I can request an implementation. But OSGI is a dynamic system. So you saw modules can come and go at any time, right? So if I look at the list of bundles here, I see my simple implementation bundle here, which contains the actual in-memory list, of course. It has ID 5. So what happens if I just stop 5, right? So stop it. I go back to my browser, and I press refresh. Well, it seems like it still works, but it doesn't. This is just a browser cache, because if I just copy this, and I go to another another client, paste it in here, and I just do a GET request on it. You see that it has, as a return type, it has no content, which is because in the body there's going to be null. And I can show it to you from code. So if I go back to my resource over here, so this is the GET method that I'm referring to, list course. It just takes survey and it tries to do a list course. At first, when you look at this code, you would think that it will generate a null pointer exception, right? Because it tries to call a method on something which is null. So the thing is here that because I use the Felix dependency manager, that will replace this variable with a null proxy. So it's not a null object, but a null proxy. So every method which is on the proxy will just simply return null. So I will not run into a null pointer exception immediately here, but I will run into a null. So this is one of the things of the Felix dependency manager. This is sometimes it's handy, but you got to be aware of it, right? So how do I handle a situation like this? So services can come and go at any time. So do I write like a whole block of checks for null every time I want to use a service? I mean, that's one way of dealing with it, but your code will become really ugly, right? So there's another way of dealing with it, and it's also it also shows the power of OSGI. So I go to my activator from my RESTful service, and I can say after the injection of the service, I can just add another statement and say set required is true. So now I not only tell the OSGI runtime that I have a dependency on a service implementation, but it's also a required dependency. So when it's there, everything's fine. If it goes away or it's not there at deployment time, then I will start screaming, right? So I just press save over here. I touched nothing else in the system. So now, if I go to my browser and I press refresh, it says 404, right? Why? Because the resource is not there. And if I go to my OSGI console over here, well, let me put it a little bit higher for you. I can type in DM not avail, which will list me the dependencies which were not satisfied. So if I do that, it says you have an unsatisfied dependency in the system. In the survey.rest, there's an object, which is my RESTful resource, which it has become unregistered, so it was taken down by the OSGI runtime, because it depends on a service which is unavailable. Right? So OSGI will just keep your dependency management while the application is running. So it's unlike Maven. If you use Maven, right, you have your dependency management at compile time. But OSGI does dependency management at compile time, but it will keep on doing it at runtime. So as soon as something in the dependencies changes, right, it will just keep on checking all of the rules that you specified. And if it's not there, if the service is not there, it will just unregister all of the other services that have a required dependency on that service. But it also works the other way. So if I go back to my list, I forgot what the number was that I stopped. So 5 was stopped. It has the simple implementation. Now if I start 5, and I go to my browser, and I press refresh, it works. Because now the service that I have a required dependency on became available. So OSGI will automatically rewire all of the dependencies, and now my RESTful resource can start, and it's working. Right? So this is very powerful dependency management, and it works every time you do an update into a running system. So imagine if you build cloud components that have to be up for 24/7, so they can't have any downtime. So you can have multiple versions of the same service. Let's say you have like 3 or 2 versions of a implementation that holds a list of scores, and if one goes down for maintenance, you still have the other one, and everything will dynamically be rewired. And you can do dynamic updates. So this is a really, really powerful feature. So enough about this. Let's move on with the application and make it a little bit more beautiful, because it's now just ugly code. And let's add in some static stuff, some user interface, right? Because, it's going to be a cloud application. So I got something prepared. Of course, we could use a stateful web services framework or a stateful web framework, like we could use Vadin or what else, to create a beautiful modular Java user interface. But I don't think that, server-side stateful web frameworks, they're not really modern anymore, right? So we need to have something else. We need to have HTML5 and JavaScript and HTML, right? That's cool. So I just have a static folder over here. I just drag it into my project. And in this folder is just some static stuff. So it's just a couple of HTML pages, very simple ones, and a little bit of JavaScript. You'll see it in a minute. And now, how do I deal with this JavaScript and HTML stuff in an OSGI application? So the trick is just create another bundle, right? So we do a new bundle descriptor, which will trigger a new jar file. Call it UI, user interface. And then instead of dragging in packages, I go to the source tab over here. And then I add a couple of headers for BND. This is also a way in order to instruct BND to generate stuff. So I say, everything that's in the static folder in my project, you should put that in the root of the jar file. And everything that's in the static/script folder of my project, put that in a folder called script. And then start serving this web application from the root of the website that you deploy this on. So if I save this, I get a new jar file over here, service.ui.jar, and if I open it, it has my 3 HTML files, and it has my JavaScript, some jQuery library, and it also has OSGI metadata, right? And this is just another module, right? And this is just private stuff. It's not meant to be shared on an OSGI level, right? But it holds implementation code. Now, if you have a static web application, there's multiple parts of the application that you know can do without each other. And if they, so you can put them in different modules, so you can create 10 modules containing your parts of your website. And if they have to refer to each other, you just create hyperlinks, right? So that's how you do a modular JavaScript front end. So you can have put everything in one jar file or just have like 10 jar files. Now, it's immediately deployed as well. So let me see. If I do a list bundles, then I see that my survey.ui is there as well. So I can go to Chrome. And then I can say, well, localhost index.html. Here we go. And now we have a little bit of a fancy front end. So I can do something here. So I'm going to be John Doe. Skip my email address. And I really like this talk. And I say, wow, cool. Submit, thank you for our feedback. And now if I go back to REST, you see it will post something and it will be listed into the system, right? I can also create a post myself. I can use this REST tool and create a new post request, and then I have to type some JSON body, right? And then I can just post to the server. I also created something else, which also in the user interface, which is report.html. And this just simply lists all the replies in a table. And then I can I'll show you the code, actually. It's something not that fancy, but... So it has a very simple table set up in HTML, right? And then as soon as somebody calls this page, it will trigger the getScores method over here, which basically does a jQuery AJAX call to the server, just does a get on slash survey that we just did ourselves as well. Then it gets a JSON structure back, and it will call the renderScore method, which is below. That will just take the body of the table, throw everything away, and then you know, iterate over the list and just add a new item for all of the entries. And then I will just do some crazy math over here just to calculate the average, which will say as well, you have a 4.5 out of a maximum score of 5, right? And then there's this list, this stuff as CSV as well. So I can download a CSV file, right? And then if I click on it, you see the power of Microsoft Excel. Well, this is a really complicated CSV file, so Excel has to think about this. But there you have it. Right, so I can show you the code of the resource as well. So it's not really spectacular code. I just produce text slash CSV instead of JSON, and then I have this string builder that goes through with a list of scores and then appends the items separated by semicolon. All right. Very simple application. We have some time left. So everything is now running on my local system, which is nice for development. I didn't have to restart the environment once, so I just can keep on developing whatever I'm doing in the same running application. But for now, I will shut it down. And I will. I want to deploy this stuff into the cloud, right? Because we're building a cloud application, so we're not running it from my machine. We're going to run it from the other side of the internet. So for that, I go back to my project configuration, go to the run tab, and it has the export button over here. And I can create an executable jar file, or I can just export to a folder. So let me export this to a folder called demo. And then if I look over there, you see that it now exported a whole bunch of jar files. Not only my jar files, the ones below, but also all of the dependencies and transitive dependencies that my application has. Now, as you can see, if you compare this to regular server-side development, you usually end up with one WAR file, or with an ear file, or a couple WAR files, right? But not, you know, this much jar files. So how do we keep track of everything? I mean, everything will be wired against each other at runtime, but this is a whole bunch of jar files, and your administrator will probably not be, you know, very happy with you throwing him just a whole bunch of jar files, right? And this is just a very simple application. In production, we built applications that have over 250 jar files, right? So how do you keep track of them? Well, Let me quickly switch back to slides, just for 1 second. So how do you keep track of them? So what I'm going to be using next is something called Apache Ace. And Apache Ace is a provisioning and deployment server. So basically, my development machine is on the left. And what I just did is I exported the list of bundles that I'm going to use. And then I will upload those bundles into the Apache Ace repository. I will start Ace in a second. And then I have a number of targets, for example, nodes running in the cloud. It can just be one server, but it can also be a whole bunch of servers. Actually, it says server here, but it can be anything that can run a Java virtual machine. So it can also be a tablet, or a Raspberry Pi, or whatever embedded device you have that can connect from a Java virtual machine to the internet. Right? So you can connect these to the Ace server using some agent callback system, and then Ace can start provisioning software to the nodes. So let me demonstrate that to you. So I'm going to the command prompt here. I will start Ace. Ace is an OSGI application as well, and it's built with Vadin. Well, let me show you what a user interface looks like that is built by programmers. Let me quickly log into Ace. This is what a user interface looks like, which is built by programmers, right? So it's not pretty, but it's functional, kind of. So everything I'll show you here in from a user interface perspective can also be done by scripting or by doing RESTful calls against Ace. It has a very nice API. So this is an empty server. So I'm going to add some artifacts. And I go to my collection of bundles over here that I just exported. Select all of them. And I drag them into this dialog. And I press Add. And now all of the bundles of my application are now in Ace. If I press Store, I just stored them into the repository. Now the columns over here, they're actually columns. It's hard to see for you because of the colors. But there's a second column here that says Features. So you can add a feature. For example, I can create an API feature. And then I take my survey.api bundle and drag that on top of the API over here. Right. And now I have a feature of my application. So you can store it. You can create another feature. For example, the GoGo shell. So I create GoGo. And I pick the GoGo runtime. And just drag it over there. So it gives some visual feedback about what's included. That's nice. And then I press store. And now I have two features. And then I can create a distribution. So for example, I'm going to create a demo distribution. And the demo is going to hold both of the features. So I just drag them onto demo. Right. Press store. And now everything is ready to be provisioned out to target. But I don't have a target yet. So earlier on, I tried to do it directly to a cloud image, but I had some trouble with the callbacks to the firewall here. So I've had a backup plan, fortunately. And the backup plan is a Linux image, which I'm running on my machine. So let's pretend this is a cloud node, right? And then let me quickly check if the IP address didn't change. Because I need to do a callback. No, it's still the same. So what I'm doing here, I'm launching something which is called the Ace Launcher, which is essentially the Java virtual machine with a Apache Felix OSGI runtime in it and the Ace agent, so the Ace client, so to speak. And then I'm giving it two parameters. I'm giving it an identification, which is a name. So this name will be visible in Ace. And I give it a discovery URL, which is actually the IP address of my macOS, which runs the Ace repository, and then the port on which Ace currently runs. So if I start this, let's start this. So now the Java virtual machine is running, the OSGI framework is running. It's not doing anything yet because it's empty. And then I can switch back to Ace over here. And if I press retrieve, and hopefully, yes, there it is. We see the cloud node popping up, right? So we have the callback. And you can have, you know, millions of them. And then what we do is we just pick demo, our distribution, and we say, well, this distribution goes on that node, right? And then if I press store here, I will quickly switch to the console. And then if you're lucky, yes. So I just deployed the API module and I deployed GoGo. So you see the prompt from GoGo. So if I do LB now, list bundles, then it will say, well, I got your survey API and your GoGo shell in there. Okay? So this is just for a single deployment. Now, let's go back to Ace and say, well, add a new feature. Let's call it survey. Okay, and then we're going to just drag everything in, except for the API and the GoGo shell, which are already in the other features. So drop it on there. And then I just drop this on demo. And now, because it's already linked to the cloud node, it sees it gets an update, and it will start to push the delta of bundles to the target, right? So not everything again. It will also not stop the application on the client. It will just keeps on running, but it will just deploy new bundles in the OCI runtime. So I press store, switch over, and we see added new score. So something is already working, and I see a HTTP server starting up. So now, if I start a browser, right, I go to localhost, survey. There you have it. It's working now, right? So I can do, you know, deltas. I can just push deltas. And Ace is really, really smart. So it looks at the OSGI versioning. So as soon as I just create a new version of my API or a new version of my implementation, and it's just a minor change, then Ace will automatically replace this in the features, and it will just push it out immediately. But it has to be minor because you can't have breaking changes, obviously. So if it has breaking changes, then BND Tools will do a major version. And if Ace sees a major version, it will just list it in the repository. Then I have to manually put it into one of the features, and then it will send it out, right? So you have control over what you can do. And since this is all scriptable, and you can use the REST APIs of Ace, you can put this into your automatic build environment. So every time you build, you run your quality, your unit tests, and then if everything succeeds, you just push your bits into Ace, and if they're just a snapshot update, then Ace will automatically push them out to your nodes, so you have a really nice way of doing continuous delivery, right? This is pretty cool. So now, most of the demo worked, actually everything worked. I have an assignment for you, because I think we're almost out of time. So if you want to win a copy of the book, just have one, bring out your tablet, laptop, or phone, and you go to survey.bertertman.com. You can read it. So that's a real cloud instance that runs somewhere, which has the same application. If you're the first one to fill out a new survey, and you give me a 5, you get the book. So I give you a minute. I can fill it out myself, but I think it's pretty lame if I'm the first one. So yeah, that's me, but I won't give the book to myself. So I see some people typing, so press refresh. Couple times. Yes, we have a winner, Flavio. Okay. Congratulations, you get a book. Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much. If you didn't win the book, but you want one, I have a couple of coupons over here that will give you a 50% discount on the ebook. So you can get one of the coupons. And if you have any questions, please feel free to come down and ask them to me. Thank you.